Hi, Plymouth Church. Welcome to the worship of God, right here and there and wherever you are, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey. You are always welcome here, no matter where here is. Right here under the loving arms of God, to worship, to pray, to listen, to grow, to connect in mind and spirit with one another and with God. So welcome. Here at Plymouth Church, our mission is to grow together in love of God and neighbor. And we're still doing that, friends. There's people diving into scripture and books via Facebook and Zoom, sharing stories of their lives being in prayer with one another. There's folks meeting with committees and boards, using their minds and hearts to think creatively about how we can continue to grow together in love of God and neighbor. There's mask makers and service project thinkers and doers, people of God. If you're longing for connection, reach out. Let us know. We can help. I know we aren't passing those red friendship pads down the rows like we usually do, so make sure you're still letting us know that you are here and say hello. Say hello on Facebook, on a Facebook video that we're posting. Say hello on Zoom, like it, share it, engage in conversation about it afterwards, and then email your pastors. Share with us an article, a thought, a prayer, a concern. Call a Plymouth member that you haven't seen in a while that you're thinking about. Ministers of Plymouth Church, yes, that's you. Continue to care for one another. We are grateful, and it is a blessing. Now, beloved people of God, as always, the good work we are able to do out in the world, the things we are able to do together in God's name, as well as paying the bills, all stems from what we share. If you're struggling financially right now, know that Plymouth Church has some means to help, so reach out. We also know that there are some of you who are in the position to give a little more right now. So if you find yourself in a place of greater financial stability or comfort, and maybe you're finding yourself wondering how you can share some of what you have, please prayerfully consider if you're called to increase your giving during this time. Whatever your gift, people of God, we thank you. Beloved, we come together this morning to worship God. So now let us be called into this time of worship, of praise, of prayer, and song.
Thank you.
Beloved, let us pray. Loving God, we come this morning seeking to abide in your presence, asking for your spirit to move around us and in us. Open our minds to your spirit of wisdom, that we may better know how to live as your people. Open our hearts to your spirit of truth, that we may love all your people with a love that speaks of justice, kindness, and radical grace. May our worship together this morning be a picture of walking humbly with you. God, we pray in your Son's name and in the words he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. When we just don't understand, God still loves. When we think we aren't enough, God says we are loved. When we're feeling weak and low, God reminds us that we are strong and so very loved. When we attend the work of justice, engage in the heart work of loving kindness, and set our intentions on a humble walk, our God is walking with us. Thanks be to God. Amen.
People of God, we continue to be blessed this summer by the gifts of Plymouth members as together we pursue the heart of the matter. Every story is a God story because God is at work in and through all things, in and through our lives. If a story that you've heard this summer speaks to you, consider that a nudge from the Holy Spirit, encouraging you to reach out to that Plymouth member to connect. And if a story inspires you to share your own story, consider that a nudge from the Holy Spirit to reach out to me and let me know so that we can include you in our testimonies this summer. This week we hear a story from Maggie Tillman about how she got clear about what matters most and found new life on the heels of great loss. Let's hear from Maggie.
Greetings, Plymouth Church. My name is Maggie Tillman and I'm 34 years old. I've been going to Plymouth for about 4 years with being an official member for the last year and a half. And this is my story. I am a divorced person. Now you might say, Maggie, half of Americans get divorced. What's the big deal? Well, the big deal is the journey I took after my divorce. It started back in April 2016. I was running errands one day, and when I came home, my ex-husband was nowhere to be found. I waited about a half an hour or so just to see if he would come back, and he still hadn't showed. After that, I had called him and I asked him where he was at. At that moment, he had said, "Have you read the note yet?" And when he said that, I stumbled upon a handwritten note that he had left out for me. It had said, "I don't think I love you anymore. And it's unfair for you and I to keep this relationship going." I was completely floored, to be an understatement. And it came as a complete shock to me, as he had never indicated that he was unhappy, out of love, or even wanted to separate. As I came to find out, he had found another woman and was building a relationship with her instead of his wife. Now, during our marriage, I had given myself completely to him. Whatever his interests and likes were, we were to pursue those. I couldn't even bring up anything I liked because it wasn't what he wanted. And in the end, I lost my sense of self and identity. So when he announced that he was leaving me, I didn't know where to begin. How do I build a life that I had lost? Not to mention the grief and trauma that goes into divorcing a marriage. But piece by piece, I slowly started to regain myself, recover my lost identity, become Maggie again. It has been a journey and a long road to remember who I was before my 6-year marriage. There's been a few stumbles along the way, no doubt, and opportunities for growth. But I would not be where I am today without the strength and resiliency I've developed post my divorce. And I love who I am today, and I'm bound and determined never to lose her again. And I'll leave you with a quote from Morgan Harper Nichols that is a summation of my journey. And one day you will look back and see through all the chaos, there was grace. You still became who you were meant to be.
Good morning, Plymouth kids. I am wearing this also awesome Lego spaceman face shield that my husband made this morning because it has Velcro on it. If you've got a toy or a shoe or a piece of clothing with Velcro, run and get it quick so that we can investigate it together. All right? Have you got it? Getting close? All right. Now, before we get to the Velcro, let's get to our scripture for today. Micah 6:8. God has told you what is good. And what does God require of you but to do justice, love, kindness, and walk humbly with your God? The email this week will have some fun ideas for your family about how to love kindness and walk humbly. So we're going to just stick with the first one this morning, do justice. What does it look like to do justice? What does it feel like to do justice? I'll tell you, not so long ago, I thought doing justice must involve a lot of hammering. I had seen some judges on TV pounding gavels, a very special kind of hammer, not exactly like this one, but not so far away from it either. And so I got the idea, maybe you're smarter than me, maybe you've gotten this idea mixed up in your heads too, but I got the idea that justice must mean judgment, and judgment must mean punishment. And hammers seem like an ouch kind of tool for punishments. Scary and not very fun. But then I got to know some people who do the work of judging and justice. And while human justice is not perfect, I heard some stories that got me thinking about justice differently. I heard about judges who help create families through adoption. I heard a story about a little boy coming into a courtroom with the people who would become his official parents with a smile as big as his face on, saying, "They chose me." Justice can be like this too, not a hammer bringing down a punishment, but something that helps bind people together, helps restore people to wholeness, to each other. And so I want you to take a look at your Velcro now, if you've got it. You can look really close at it. You might see that one side has all these little hooks and the other side has all these little loops, and the parts are meant to go together. They're very different, but they're meant to stick together. And when we hear the prophet Micah say that God wants us to do justice, I think that's an invitation to find ways to stick to each other for the good of ourselves and our families and our communities. Sometimes that involves saying we're sorry. Sometimes that involves giving big hugs to show love. Sometimes that involves being chosen and choosing one another. And God's justice is not about hammering out a punishment on anyone, but making sure we're all restored to each other, stuck together, and made whole. So let's pray. Will you repeat after me? God, we thank you for Velcro and for justice and the things that help us stick together and make us whole. Help us to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with you. Amen.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on. Light, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near when my life is almost gone. Hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand lest I fall. Take my hand, precious Lord. Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am so tired, I am weak, and I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of the prophet Micah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt, and I redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I set before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam son of Beor answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before God with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with tens of thousands of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with God? Here ends this reading of Scripture. May God help us to hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Let us pray. Let the good news come now, O God, not only in word, but in power, with the Holy Spirit and full assurance. Through Christ we pray. Amen. Gift giving is complicated. Giving gifts, receiving gifts, the more you think about it, the more complicated it becomes. Have you ever had the experience of receiving a gift that you really didn't want? A gift that suggests that the person who gave it to you doesn't really know you at all, and you have to sit there and unwrap it and feign delight. Oh, soap. What's worse, have you perhaps ever given someone else a gift that was somehow inappropriate or revealed that you really didn't know them all that well? It's a tough situation to be in. Gift giving is complicated. When I think about giving gifts, I think of Billy Collins' wonderful poem, The Lanyard. The other day, I was ricocheting slowly off the blue walls of this room, moving as if underwater, from typewriter to piano, from bookshelf to an envelope lying on the floor, when I found myself in the L section of the dictionary, where my eyes fell upon the word lanyard. No cookie nibbled by a French novelist could send one into the past more suddenly. A past where I sat at a workbench at a camp by a deep Adirondack lake, learning how to braid long, thin plastic strips into a lanyard, a gift for my mother. I'd never seen anyone use a lanyard or wear one, if that's what you did with them. But that did not keep me from crossing strand over strand, again and again, until I had made a boxy red and white lanyard for my mother. She gave me life and milk from her breasts, and I gave her a lanyard. She nursed me in many a sick room, lifted spoons of medicine to my lips, laid cold face cloths on my forehead, and then led me out into the airy light and taught me to walk and swim, and I, in turn, presented her with a lanyard. "Here are thousands of meals," she said, "and here is clothing and a good education." "And here is your lanyard," I replied, "which I made with a little help from a counselor. Here is a breathing body and a beating heart, strong legs, bones, and teeth, and two clear eyes to read the world," she whispered. "And here," I said, "is the lanyard I made at camp. And here, I wish to say to her now, is a smaller gift. Not the worn truth that you can never repay your mother, but the rueful admission that when she took the two-tone lanyard from my hand, I was as sure as a boy could be that this useless, worthless thing I wove out of boredom would be enough to make us even." Gift-giving is complicated. So many of us know and cherish Micah 6, verse 8. He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with God. But our reading this morning reminds us that these words did not drop from the sky. They have an occasion, they have a context. These words are spoken in the middle of something that sounds to me a lot like a lover's spat, an argument between God and Israel. And each one in exasperation says to the other, "What do you want from me?" Why are they arguing? What is this about? Well, the prophet Micah lived and worked about 800 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. It was a time of tremendous crisis for the people of God. The Assyrian Empire conquered the northern nation of Israel, very nearly conquered the southern nation of Judah. The people were defeated in battle, carried off into bitter exile, enslaved and oppressed. It is a time of crisis for the people. But it's also a time of crisis for God's relationship with God's people. Things don't seem to be going very well. You can tell things aren't going very well because in Micah chapter 6, God impanels the mountains of Israel as a kind of jury. Seats them as a jury and then makes the case against Israel. "Israel," says God, "has not been grateful to me. Israel has not responded to my love. For the Lord has a controversy with the people. God will contend with Israel." And then listen to God plead with God's people. "What have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me." And God goes into this litany of reciting the saving acts of the Lord, as if to say, "Look what I have done on your behalf. I brought you out of Egypt. I redeemed you from slavery. I gave you Moses and Aaron and Miriam to lead you. But I guess that wasn't enough. Remember what King Balak did and what Balaam answered. We don't need to get into the details of that. It's God continuing to recite the history. Look at what I have done. Why are you ungrateful? But God and Israel are talking past each other in the story. Because then at verse 6, Israel or some representative of Israel sounds equally exasperated. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself down before God on high? Shall I come with burnt offerings of calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams and 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Do you hear the exasperation? This is the kind of exaggeration and hyperbole that people use when they are locked in argument with each other. What they actually seem to be doing is talking past each other. Because God says, I did all of these things for you. And Israel says, we know. That's why we sacrifice all of these animals. That's why we've invested so much in your temple. That's why we put so much energy into the worship of you. How much more do you want? Do you want a bigger temple? Do you want brighter stained glass? Do you want a louder organ? What's it going to take, God? And so it is in exasperation that God speaks the famous words of verse 8, or rather the prophet speaks them. He has told you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with God. See, Micah shows us something that is very hard for church people to hear. What does God want? God wants justice. And what do we keep trying to give God? We keep trying to give God religion, church. God says, I want you to do right by your neighbor. And we say, look at these beautiful candles on the communion table. God says, I want you to care about the widow and the orphan. And we say, God, didn't we do a wonderful job remodeling our sanctuary? God says that there are people in pain. They may be invisible to you, but they are living right in your community, and you need to help them. And we say, God, we've got a committee meeting scheduled for Tuesday after next where we're going to talk about that. God wants justice, and we offer up religion. And so we end up talking right past each other. It's what happens in Micah's day, and I believe it's what happens in ours. We're continuing our church-wide reading of Marcus Borg's The Heart of Christianity. Last week we talked about being born again and personal transformation, and this week we're talking about societal transformation that the prophets of Israel proclaimed and Jesus of Nazareth preached, that God wants justice. God is interested in how the least and the marginalized and the most vulnerable among us are doing. How are they? Are we concerned about how it is with them? God wants justice. And at least in this reading from Micah, you see this disconnect between God and God's people, that all of the ritual and sacrifice, all of the pomp and circumstance of religion is like the lanyard that Billy Collins offers his mother. Look what we did, God. Look at the church we built for you. Look at the songs that we're singing. Look at all of our busy committee activity. How much more sometimes we get exasperated too. How much more, God, do you want from us? What else is it going to take? And all the while, what if God stands shaking God's head saying, no, I didn't ask you for any of this. What I want is justice. What I want is kindness. What I want is for you to walk humbly with me. So the work of justice, interrogating and challenging the racism in our society and in ourselves, doing right by the immigrant and the refugee, caring for the climate. These things are not optional, they're not add-ons, they're not intrusions into our worship. To hear Micah tell it, these are the things that matter most to God. All of our singing, all of our praying, all of our giving, and yes, all of our meetings are only a means to the end of justice and kindness and walking humbly with God. That's what God is after. That's what this is about. That is why we do justice. So reading Micah, I cannot help but wonder if God sometimes gets exasperated with me because I come dragging all of my religious busyness before God and I say, isn't this it, God? Isn't this what you want? Or are you finally impressed with me? But the remarkable thing is this. 28 centuries after Micah spoke these words, God has not given up on us. God is not finished with us. Exasperated sometimes, yes. Throwing in the towel? I don't think so. In love, God keeps coming to religious folk, to people like me in places like this, and saying, this is great. Now, how about some justice? How about some kindness? How about some humble walking with me? That's what God really wants. And thank God, God will not give up on us until God gets it. Amen.
People of God, let us pray. First, with a moment of silence, making room for God to pray in us. Holy One, our hearts yearn for justice to roll down like waters, for righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. We hear the cries of creation all around us, the rattling bones of our institutions, and we want things to be fresh, to be new, to be whole. Remind us that while hammers may be useful tools for building and challenging and changing institutions, they are not the best tools for building up or challenging or changing hearts. Remind us that the work of justice is meant to restore us, O God. Restore us to ourselves, to each other, and to you. Remind us that you keep calling, keep urging, keep inviting us, O God, into the sticky work of justice with you, where all people are cared for and on earth is a little closer to in heaven. Help us to walk the path toward justice with loving kindness and humility, learning from our neighbors as we go. O God, we pray this day for all whose lives are impacted by systems of racism. We pray for protesters and all in prison, for law enforcement officers who get leaned on to enforce the status quo, and movement builders who are working to shift it. We pray for communities that experience the pain of profiling and communities that experience the peace of protection. May your restoring justice touch us all. Holy One, we pray this day for all whose lives are touched by our systems of education, for children and parents, teachers and administrators, bus drivers, custodians, paras and cafeteria workers, school board members, concerned citizens, and so many more. As debate continues about what is best for children and families during a pandemic, help us to be creative and humble and kind in our dealings with each other. May your loving kindness be our guide. Holy One, we pray this day for all whose lives are wrapped up in our systems of healthcare, for care providers and patients, emergency responders and researchers, vaccine developers and manufacturers of protective equipment, family members and data crunchers, and all of us, really, as we are daily reminded of the preciousness of life. In the midst of the monotony, O God, keep us mindful of the preciousness of life. Help us to keep walking humbly with you. We lift these and the prayers of our inmost hearts to you, O God, trusting that you hear them. We pray in the name of the one who shows us with his life what it is to do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with you. Amen.
And now, Plymouth Church, go forth to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with God, knowing that that's what God wants from your life and from our life together. And as you go into that sacred work, may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God look upon you with kindness and give you peace, now and always.